The following program is made possible in part by the ministry partners of the Hour of Power and viewers like you.
Mao made a great analogy. He said, we know what the last page says. Here's what the last page says. I know what the last page says. Do you? I know what the last page says. It says the dead shall rise. It says the sick shall be healed. It says the silos shall be full. It says the womb shall be blessed. It says the lion and the lamb shall lay together. It says the wicked shall be punished. It says the saints shall praise the lamb. And it says that Christ shall have the victory. Amen. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Good morning.
It is a great morning, and thank you so much for being here. Today, as we worship, let's obey God and cast all anxious thoughts upon Him, for He cares for us. Thank you so much for being here. We love you.
Yeah, we're so glad you're here. Let's begin with a prayer of worship. And Father, we come to you in Jesus' name. We thank you, God, that you're here now. And we do come to worship you and to thank you for all the good that's happening in our lives. Father, we're coming here to trust you. We're coming here to hear your word, to grow in faith, to know what it means to walk in belief and in power. Lord, we trust you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. All God's people said, amen.
Turn to the person next to you and say, God loves you and so do I.
Good morning, church. We're going to start our worship this morning with a hymn, a traditional hymn from long ago, something that I and many of us learned at the Crystal Cathedral. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. And we will punctuate that with a hallelujah, hallelujah. We will praise the Lord together. Stand with us and let's sing this doxology together.
Praise Him above the heavens.
Would you open your Bibles with me to Job 42:10? And this is the New Living Translation. When Job prayed for his friends, the Lord restored his fortunes. In fact, the Lord gave him twice as much as before. Then all his brothers and sisters and former friends came and feasted with him in his home. And they consoled him and comforted him because of all the trials the Lord had brought against him. And each of them brought him a gift of money and a gold ring. So the Lord blessed Job in the second half of his life even more than in the beginning. For now he had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, 1,000 teams of oxen, and 1,000 female donkeys. In all the land, no women were as lovely as the daughters of Job, and their father put them into his will along with their brothers. Job lived 140 years after that, living to see four generations of his children and grandchildren. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you for being a part of our church family. We're so glad you're worshiping with us today.
Perhaps you know someone today who could benefit from hearing the encouraging, hope-filled messages and music that make up Hour of Power services each week. Tell them about this program. You may forever change their life.
We want to remind you that every Saturday, a new Hour of Power episode is posted to our website, hourofpower.org. If you want to receive a notification when the latest program is available, text the word NEW to 25252.
Our website also has special resources just for you. Sign up to receive our daily Positive Minute Devotions or monthly Power Lines newsletter. If you're ever in Orange County area, join us for our Sunday services at 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. and 25 minutes before each of those services. Join me for pre-service prayer. We'd love for you to experience our worship services live.
Thank you so much for continuing to believe in our worldwide mission. Your financial support and words of encouragement mean the world to us, and we couldn't do ministry without you. Thank you, and remember, as always, God loves you, and so do we.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord.
Pavela Cunnington is an author, podcast host, and pastor who has served in ministry for over 20 years. She currently serves at Bethel Church in Redding, California, as the women's pastor. Her new book, Created to Hear God, Four Unique and Proven Ways to Confidently Discern His Voice, provides readers with a guide on how to recognize God's voice and how it isn't as complicated as we think. Please welcome Pavela Cunnington.
Pavela, hi. Thank you so much for joining us. Welcome.
Thank you for having me.
You guys are up north in Redding, California, so we're your Southern California brothers and sisters down here. But you're up at Bethel Church. What an awesome place to do ministry, leading women there, listening to the Spirit. And I'm super excited about your book, Created to Hear God. But before we jump into that, tell us a little bit about your faith journey.
Yeah, so I was a pastor's kid who was really kind of trying to stay under the radar. It really happened in third grade when I was diagnosed with dyslexia and reading and comprehension issues and some ADHD. And so I just felt like I was kind of broken. And then when I got into my faith, I felt also like I had nothing to really offer. I wasn't really amazing at anything. I wasn't a singer. I wasn't, you know, all the things. And so when I was a teenager, I was really motivated to stay under the radar in both academics and at church. And one night, some guys picked my twin sister, I have an identical twin sister, up to go to a party. And in the backseat of this car, we're just going to a party we would normally go to. The Holy Spirit speaks to me. And it's not audible, but it's that clear, still voice that's just something you weren't even thinking about. And he says to me, Pavela, what are you doing? And it got my attention, and I knew he was saying something, and he said, you've got to get out of here. You have a call on your life. You've got to get out of this car. Yeah. So I didn't know what to do, but at 17, I asked the guys in the front to turn the music down, and I awkwardly blurred out, I have a call of God on my life, which nobody responds. It's very, very awkward.
Yeah.
And then through tears, I say, I'm going to serve God. This is what I'm going to do. And they ended up taking us home without us even asking to go home. We never made it to the party. But I went into my bedroom that night and I, through tears, knelt by my bed and said, God, I'm not much. I'm young. I'm 17. I'm a girl. I have obviously other challenges. I don't really think I could do anything significant for you. And yet, if you can use me, I'm available. And that was really I call it my going public night.
Yeah.
Where I think all of us have to go public in our faith, because once we go public, grace happens. Amen. And we begin to live in one world. So, yeah.
There is something really important about that public declaration, isn't there? I mean, I think often about the Bible verse where Jesus says something like, if you deny me before others, I'll deny you. If you acknowledge me before others, I'll acknowledge you before my Father. And I think often about how, even sometimes as a pastor, I kind of like try not to let people know I'm a pastor if it's my day off. And I kind of just want to have my coffee, you know? And I think, that's not it, you know? That's not it, brother. I got to be, you know, I don't get to choose a day off for the Lord, you know? And for as a women's pastor, I think, man, it's probably interesting. You probably have a lot of women actually at Bethel asking you. I mean, it's a church that encourages hearing God's voice, receiving revelation from the Holy Spirit. I'm sure you've had a lot of coaching one-on-one, talking with women about, you know, how to hear God's voice. One of my big questions would be, and there's also probably people like in the secular world
that watch the show that are thinking like, are these people crazy? Are they hearing, are they hearing like audible, like, you know, Monty Python voices coming out of the sky or something? If you were gonna tell someone who's either a new Christian or someone that is not familiar with the faith, what we mean when we talk about hearing God's voice, I think there were like four or five things you mentioned in your book that I thought were super good. Can we talk about those and sort of like what we're talking about when we mean hearing God's voice?
Yeah, so you and I both know we're not looking for audible voices. If you are hearing consistent audible voices, then we would say, okay, you know, obviously there might be another challenge, but we're talking about an inner knowing, a voice of the Holy Spirit that resonates within us. And I often was, as a young woman and in ministry almost 30 years now, I find that my battle that I thought was my own, which is I don't know how to hear God's voice, I'm not sure, and the person across the way really knows, I found that I wasn't alone and that I thought everyone heard God the same way. And the way that I was taught how to hear was a specific, you know, method. And when I began to learn how to hear God's voice and teach thousands of people on how to hear God's voice, I found that we were not all hearing the same thing. Yeah. And what I found was that it wasn't just my battle. It was a collective battle of people in the faith that say, when you say God speaks, I don't know what you're talking about. Or I can only think of this hero that knows what God is saying and I don't. And I don't know what to do about it. So I kind of really went on this journey to figure out how do we actually engage in hearing God's voice? And I call it prophetic personalities, like the five love languages.
Yeah.
I find that God has given us this ability to connect with him uniquely. I think one of the problems we've done is we have put everybody in the same box at our faith environments. Everyone hears God this way. And so what I found, there are four methods. So again, these are just ways that, again, God doesn't need a strategy. We have the Bible. He can speak to us in any way he wants to. So we are not boxing God in to be sovereign and supernatural. Sure. But I do want to start to unpack what are ways we can clearly identify. So I call it the knower, feeler, seer, and hearer. So just simply, it's this. The knower is the light bulb. They're the one that knows something. It's like they walk in a room and they know. It's like when I was in the backseat of the car and I knew I had to get out of there, there was a supernatural knowing.
Did like
I
a hear gut thing, voice? Right?
A gut. It's like a, and it rises to the surface. It's like they say, you know it in your knower. It's rises to the surface. There's no visuals or audible or, you know, there's no angel. It's just, I know.
Yeah.
And a lot of people, honestly, a lot of my knowers feel like heathens in church because they don't have a seeing and a hearing and all the you know, fireworks. Yeah. They simply just know. It's like they know the truth and they have this intuition and it's supernatural. So God speaks to a knower through an intuition, a wisdom, clarity, a prompting. Paul took Timothy instinctively. There are those of you that think you can't hear God, and yet you have intuitively and supernaturally made decisions and life choices that have aligned with the will of God for your life. Then you have your seer. Your seer are those that God speaks to through pictures, imagery, dreams, visions. They're the ones that they see the orphanage being built and they're instantly filled with faith for it.
Yeah.
Or God speaks to them in a kind of a picture in their mind where they see it playing out.
I feel like Sean Bowles, I feel like he's kind of that way.
Exactly. Sean is very much, he's a friend of mine and he's very much like that.
Yeah.
And seers are actually very unique. In fact, we gave 155,000 people the prophetic personality test and we found that the least amount were seers. So if you're a seer, you're on a unique level of hearing God through imagery, dreams, and visions. Then you have your hearers. And your hearers are those classic, like you and I were taught that hearing God, most of us were brought to the story with Samuel, which is, you know, Eli says to him, go lay down, ask God, you know, speak for your servant is listening. That's how we were taught, was that we would hear words, phrases, conversations, narrations. And so your hearers are their classic. They're the kind of the traditional, and they really have a conversational relationship with God. They have a play-by-play. They hear something, they go a little bit longer, they hear something else. And they're kind of classic journalers. They're really good at kind of documenting what God is saying.
Yeah.
And they have a lot of words. And then lastly, you have our feelers. And our feelers are those that God interacts with in a very emotional, physical way. It can be a burden. It can be an emotion of feeling his heart for somebody or knowing what you're supposed to do or how to actually pray about something. Feelers are those that when they go into an environment, they actually experience something physically. And so many times we go, well, does everyone experience that? No. Does that make them wrong? No. It makes them different. And what I've found is that all of us experience love uniquely, and all of us are created to hear God differently. And so the goal is not to compare. The goal is to figure out your primary way in which God interacts with you, and then grow in the other areas that are available to us.
Awesome. I want to encourage you, if you're watching now and you want to know like which of those five ways you feel like you hear from God, to get a copy of Havilah Cunnington's book, Created to Hear God. Thank you, Havilah, for joining us. We appreciate you so much. And we're looking forward to reading your book. God bless you. Thanks.
Thank you.
The heavens declare your greatness and power. Creation proclaims the works of your hands. Holy, holy.
Thank you for being a part of our church family. We're so glad you're worshiping with us today.
Perhaps you know someone today who could benefit from hearing the encouraging, hope-filled messages and music that make up our Power Services each week. tell them about this program. You may forever change their life.
We want to remind you that every Saturday, a new Hour of Power episode is posted to our website, hourofpower.org. If you want to receive a notification when the latest program is available, text the word NEW to 25252.
Our website also has special resources just for you. Sign up to receive our daily Positive Minute Devotions or monthly Power Lines newsletter. If you're ever in Orange County area, join us for our Sunday services at 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. and 25 minutes before each of those services. Join me for pre-service prayer. We'd love for you to experience our worship services live.
Thank you so much for continuing to believe in our worldwide mission. Your financial support and words of encouragement mean the world to us, and we couldn't do ministry without you. Thank you, and remember, as always, God loves you, and so do we. Well, let's begin this morning. God's will. We know God's will. We know it because we're told it in the Bible. And here is what God's will is. It is God's will to bless. It is God's will to heal. It is God's will to prosper. It is God's will to restore. And it is God's will to forgive. That's really good news. It's good news that we serve a God that is good. He is only good. The only things he does is good. He is purely good. And today we're going to talk about how it is faith that unlocks the provision of heaven. It is faith. It is the true inner belief, trust in God that unlocks these things. It's the attitude and belief that comes from the knowledge of God's word that opens up our lives to his provision, his health, his life, his restoration, his forgiveness, and his meaning. Everything you want and need in life comes by faith. Everything. If the word is to be true, then this is true. The kingdom of God is like a wealthy man who went on a trip with an ATM card. But he lost his card. A man goes to a distant country. He's got an ATM card. He's got $10 million in his account, but he lost his ATM card. And now he can't get food, and he can't get around, and all he has is a ticket home. That's what so many Christians are like today. They have access to this great abundance. Not just, this isn't about money, it's about everything. Abundance to all that the kingdom of life entails. And that ATM card is faith. It's belief. It's a trust that we have access. In the Bible, there's a story of a father with an epileptic son. And his many nights, he's seen his son seizing and falling into fires and looking like he's going to die and throwing up and hoping that his son will have a future. Seeing his son lose his abilities to work and to communicate or to have a family. And he hears about this great rabbi, this great preacher that's in a nearby town. And so he goes to this rabbi we see in the book of Mark. And sort of in an act of desperation, he says, if you can do anything, please help. And here is what Jesus' response is in Mark. He says, if you can, Jesus said. Everything, and here's the part that all of us Christians, most of us, unless we're Pentecostals, makes us want to crawl under a table. Everything is possible for the one who believes. Now, I have a question for you. What if that's true? What if everything is possible for the one who believes? It's possible. It is possible. It is possible. It's possible for you if you have faith, if you believe God's word, if you trust. It is the belief. It is the trust. It is the faith that unlocks God's healing and God's provision. Here's what the man says to the great preacher. He says, I do believe. Help me with my unbelief. You ever felt that way before? You believe, but there's this other part that you don't believe. But you believe enough to go. You believe enough to attend. You believe enough to cry out. You believe enough to ask. You believe in some way. Think about this man's neighbors, his friends, his enemies, maybe his family. There he goes again, talking about the father with the epileptic son. There he goes again on another wild goose chase. There he goes again. He's going up there to see that wild preacher. He thinks that guy's going to make a difference. But he goes, and he speaks. And what does he say? I believe. I believe. I believe. If you have enough faith to speak it, you have enough faith to do it. I said, if you have enough faith to speak it, you have enough faith to do it. And faith is mostly manifested in what we say first, and then it's manifested in what we do. And so he goes and he speaks. And what does he say? I believe. Help me with my unbelief. And Jesus helped him with his unbelief by healing his son. Hallelujah. Faith is not a mystery. We experience it day in and day out. Every day we experience faith. Some of you are afraid of flying. Anybody here afraid of flying? Some of you get a little uneasy. Some of you remember why they serve alcohol on planes. You get on a plane, you feel uneasy, but you spoke and you acted. You had a feeling, but the feeling wasn't the belief. Here's what the belief was. The belief was, I'm going to Spain. And the action was, I'm buying a ticket and I'm getting on the plane. And even though you may have felt uneasy, and even though you might have felt scared, you got on the plane. And guess what? The person who's not scared of flying and the person who is scared of flying, if both of them are on the same plane, both of them get the same results. They both get to Spain. Because they have faith. Unless they're on a Boeing flight. Just kidding. Just kidding. How many of you know God's more faithful than Boeing? Amen. When I went to Chick-fil-A to get my lunch, notice how you always have to pay them first. They never give you the food and then you pay, right? You pay them first, you tell them your order, then you pay, then they hand you your food, and they say what? My pleasure. And think about that for a moment. We call it faith. You've just given them your money, and what if that girl looked out and she said, ha-ha, I'm keeping your money, get out of here. Well, what do we call that? In business, we call that what? Bad faith. But if you know Chick-fil-A, you know the Lord. It's the Lord's chicken, and you know they're going to give you your chicken. Right now, faith is a normal thing we practice every day. Right now, I have faith in my car. I do, even though I'm not driving it. Why do I have faith in my car? It's a Toyota. I have faith in my car. I know when I get to my car, I'm pretty sure it's going to run. Now, keep in mind, even though I'm not driving it, if I didn't have faith in my car, it would be hard for me to concentrate right now. I'd be thinking about how am I going to get home? I'd be thinking about how am I going to get back and how am I going to run my errands? I got to call AAA. So I'd have this whole other bandwidth going to managing a future problem in my car that's not working. And this is what happens to so many of us. We don't have faith in God, really. We don't really trust the Word. We don't really trust God with our lives. We have trouble concentrating. We have trouble thinking about our future because we're worried about this other thing. We want to know all the hows. We want to know all the whys. We want to know all the answers to the questions instead of just trusting in the Word. It says God is faithful. And because of that, it becomes very hard to plan our future. It becomes very hard to be unworried and at a state of rest that opens one's minds to big dreams and big visions. It becomes hard to be loving to your neighbor when you're stressed out and worried about your life. And this is why faith and belief in the providence, power, and most of all, goodwill of God towards you and me because of Christ crucified is the most important thing that can happen to a person. That's why we call it good news. Here's some good news. It's not because of your works. It's not because of your good works. It's because Christ faithfully laid his life down for you and for me, that we could not only be at peace with God, but receive all that heaven has. And not just when we die, we can receive it today. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. This is something interesting. It's better to be in a bad place knowing you have a good future than be in a good place knowing you have a bad future. Isn't that weird? The man in a good place with a bad future is in a worse state of mind than the man in a bad place who's guaranteed a good future. And that brings us to Job. We're going to talk about good old Job today. One of the oldest books in the Bible. Let's say, first of all, what the book of Job is. You might be surprised to hear this. Job is a parable. It's not something that happens in history, the way we would read Chronicles or a story about David or Joseph. Those are historic events. Job is a parable. We know this because it comes from one of the three major books of the wisdom literature. The first book is Proverbs, which talks about how God is just and how God rewards the righteous. The second book in the wisdom literature is Ecclesiastes, which almost says the opposite. Kind of makes it feel like the world is dark. And even though God is just, it almost seems like, where is God? And is there any meaning in life? And the third and the final book that ties it together is the parable of Job. It's a philosophical book. We know it's a parable not only because it's in the wisdom literature, but because unlike the historic books in the Old Testament, there's no dates, there's no kings mentioned, there's no battles. And in fact, Job himself is not an Israelite. Isn't that interesting? It actually says that the story of Job takes a place in a land called Uz, which is far from Israel, and Job is not a Hebrew. And there's no clear period in history at all. So the way we ought to listen to the story is not to ask the question, wait a second, are Satan and God making wagers all the time about my life and testing me? That's not the point. Here's the way you want to read and hear the story of Job. Picture Jesus Christ, or maybe in those old days, an old rabbi, telling a story to sort of tie both Ecclesiastes and Proverbs together. How do you marry this peanut butter and jelly?
Well, you do it with bread.
Job is the bread. You ready? Starts out like this. We get a picture of the heavenly court, where God is administering things to the universe, and there are various sons of God that are there, angels, something like that, and they're all talking to God, and Satan arrives. God and Satan begin to talk about Job. And here's what Satan says about Job. He says, oh, God, you're so proud of Job. He's so righteous. He's so good. He's so faithful. He's so sinless. But the only reason Job is such a good guy, the only reason he does what's right is because you bless him all the time. See, he's figured it out. He's figured out that if he's righteous and if he does what's right, you're going to bless him. But that's become the only reason he does what's good. He doesn't love what is good. He loves the money. He loves the health.
That's the only reason why.
And God says, no, no. I see his heart. He's a good guy. And so I bless him. And so back and forth they go. And they make a wager. A wager. Now, we don't know what they bet. It'd be interesting to see what that wager would be. But they make a wager. And the only rule is, you can do what you want to him, Satan, but you can't kill him. And so Satan does his work. He gets him on the big three, the big three, the three most important things that people care about. The big three. Number one, he takes his money. Number two, he takes his health. And number three, worst of all, he takes his family. And Job goes from health, blessing, family, life, love, meals, fulfillment, riches, everything, to nothing. And he enters into a period of immense suffering and sadness. On the scene arrive three friends. Now, these three friends are important because they represent the three major centers of thinking. Each city, each place that they're from, are the three major areas of philosophical thinking in the day in which Job was written during the Mesopotamians. And here's what they all say for about 36 chapters. There's a back and forth between he and his friends who say, God is just, you must have done something wrong. And they say something like, you did this wrong. And Job says, I didn't do that wrong. And so you have like a second court where Job is his own defense. You must have done this wrong. And says Job, I didn't do that. You must have done this. I didn't do that. Back and forth they go through this immense sort of Hebrew poetry until Job just finds himself for 30 chapters on this emotional roller coaster. His dead kids, his lost money and land, scraping wounds, and his health gone. And even then, he remains sinless. Even then, he doesn't break a single law. But here's what I caught from this book. I finally understood Job. And I've been waiting to preach on this. Here's what I found about Job. Job did not sin, but we also see that he did not have faith. Job did not sin, but we see that he did not have faith. Look here in Job 3, verse 25. What I feared has come upon me. What I dreaded has happened to me. This is what he says when he loses everything. What do we learn from this? He was a man in a good state that somehow had a sick feeling that he was going to lose it all. That even though on the surface everything was good, everyone's healthy, everything's fine, the money's good, everything's good, he never really trusted God. Here's what he trusted in. He trusted in his good works. Here's what he believed. He believed in a faith of propriety, what Dallas Willard says. This belief that if I do good, nothing will go wrong. If I do good, nothing will go wrong. In Christianity, we call this a good works righteousness. And what we know is that it will not save you. Who can testify to that? Propriety, good works, it's good. And Job never gives up on his good works. He never sins in his downtime, and that's good. It's good to do good works, and propriety is good. But it's not enough. What does his wife say? She says, curse God and die. What do his friends say? God has abandoned you. And then finally, in the middle of the book, what does Job say? Famously, you might remember if you went to the Christ Cathedral and you saw that old statue of that ripped guy. I was the model for that. If you look at that statue, you guys didn't know that? They didn't even pay me. Anyway, what does Job say when he's going through his immense suffering and they say, God's abandoned you, God's left you, God's doing this to you, God's unjust? What does Job say? Do you remember? Finally, it's a famous line. He says, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Amazing. This is the first time Job has faith. After he loses everything, it's the first time where Job says, even if God kills me, I will trust him. Doesn't make any sense. Does not make a lick of sense, but he says, though he slay me, I will trust him. And though it's hard for us to explain, at its heart, we know as believers, this is what faith looks like. Faith looks like when I'm at my lowest, I know God will be at his best. That God will come, that God will save, that God will rescue. Finally, in the midst of it all, he demands an audience from God. He cries out to heaven and he says, God, I need to know. I need to know why. I need to know why. Why? Why? I need an audience with you now. Thunderstorm. Amazing. This whirlwind of power and life comes and God gives Job an audience. God arrives in the storm and the whirlwind and he takes Job on a virtual tour of the universe. He takes him to see the stars and the sky and the planets. He tells him about a great battle, about how God slayed Leviathan and Behemoth. And he even brings him down to the tiniest details of the nature, from snowflakes and rams and tigers and animals and how they move and how they move about and how God has this whole universe in his hands. And Job has his mind completely blown. Completely blown. It's almost like his brain cannot hold the answer to why. Like when I was a kid, a teenager, I bought a video game. And it was a new game, but I had an old computer. And when I put the disc in, to my utter disappointment, the computer was not enough to handle the game. Can we just say, when we ask the question why, the computer is not big enough to handle the answer. And for Job, he never gets an answer, actually. The question why, which is the main question through all of Job, going on and on. If you were to read Job from the beginning, it would take you over an hour. From beginning to end, it's just why? This question is never answered once. It's answered by everybody else except God. God never answers why. He simply touches Job's heart and he blows Job's mind. And Job realizes, I have come in contact with God. And it's like all of the why and suffering and all of the fear and everything, it just goes away. Then here's what God does. He looks at those friends who were all judging him and looks at everybody that was making all of these statements about God. And what does he do? He rebukes them. And he tells Job, he says to those men, you better make a sacrifice for your sins. And he tells Job, go pray for your friends, and whatever you pray will be unto them. Job forgives his friends. And that's the last thing that happens before he receives a major blessing from God. Isn't that interesting? He prays for those who judged him, those who gave him really a false witness about God. You ever talk to somebody that seems to have all the answers, but then you get to know them and you're like, they didn't know anything. They were just with utter confidence just making that up as they were going along. And they disappeared before I got to talk to them about it and confront them. You ever meet somebody like that? Especially on the internet? See, their friends thought they knew, but they were wrong. Job forgives them. And what happens to Job? We know. He gets what we call a double portion, a double blessing. He restores it all. And he lives to be 130 years older. And he lives to see his great-great-grandchildren. And is blessed with abundance. His first blessing was because of good works. The double blessing came because of faith. Good works will get you something, and faith will get you a lot more. Hallelujah. Faith will get you a double blessing. Who wants a double blessing in the house today? Who wants more than enough today? It's not on our good works. The good work was already done. Christ was already crucified. He already paid the price. You've got the ATM card. I read Job, and I know what the last page of Job says. I know what it says, but Job doesn't. Job doesn't know what the last page says. Job didn't know when he was scraping boils off of his skin and everything was taken from him and he was completely abandoned and living under judgment. He didn't know he was in the middle of his story. He thought he was at the end. Job didn't know he was in the middle. He thought he was in the end. You're not at the end of your story. You're not at the end of your story, my friend. You're in the middle. Have faith. Have faith. Believe. Believe in God. Receive a touch from God. Reach out to God. Ask for God. Ask for more of God. This is why praise is so important. This is why worship is so important. See, many of us, we want to take a class on why. We want to take why 101. Why? 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 We want to take the why class. Don't take that class. Don't take the class on why. Here's what we do when we're going through hard times. You reach out to the Lord and let him touch your heart. Reach out to the Lord. Let him touch your life. Begin to remember all that the Lord did for you. Begin to remember all the trials he brought you through. Begin to remember that you're still alive. Begin to remember what the Word of God says. You want to increase your faith? Increase your reading. Faith doesn't come by anything but the Word of God. This Word touches our hearts. It builds us. Word by word is like brick by brick. The soul is built, lifted up. The heart is strengthened and galvanized against the many, many fiery darts of the enemy. And it is so important. It is so important that when we're going through the hard time, we keep faith alive. Here's what I know about God. God is good. He's only good all the time. Don't take the Y class. It won't help you. I've taken it many times, and I've never gotten a good answer. You know why? The computer can't hold the answer. Here's what the computer can hold. It can hold the Word of God. Speaking of computers, I don't know how a computer works. Do you? I know how to use it. I know how to surf the web. But if somebody gave me a bunch of plastic and circuits and wires, I would not know how to make a computer. And I am not interested in taking that class. Some of you are, but I am not. Just give me a Mac. Here's what Rich Mao said. Rich Mao, when he was here, he loves to read these novels. And he said, when I'm reading the novel and it gets kind of like low and it gets really hard for the hero or the main character of the story, I love to go to the last page and make sure he doesn't die. I like to go to the last page and make sure everything's fine. And then I go back to the middle and I start reading books. Now, I don't get that at all. I would never do that. But Mao made a great analogy. He said, we know what the last page says. Here's what the last page says. I know what the last page says. Do you? I know what the last page says. It says the dead shall rise. It says the sick shall be healed. It says the silos shall be full. It says the womb shall be blessed. It says the lion and the lamb shall lay together. It says the wicked shall be punished. It says the saints shall praise the lamb. And it says that Christ shall have the victory. Amen. That's what it says. We can thank you, Lord. We can trust God. We can trust him. We can believe in him. We can ask for more. We can have more from life. We can do more. We can touch lives. We can know that the final word is not from the doctor. The final word, and doctors are good, we love doctors. The final word is not from the government. The final word is not from your boss. The final word is not from your enemy. The final word is from Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. If you're not at peace with God, I want to encourage you in this moment to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Many of us, we're not like Job. You know, we've messed up. But here's the good news. You don't need to be like Job to be saved. You don't need to be like Job. You don't need to be sinless. You don't need to have everything perfectly right. You just need to count on Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Isn't that good news? It's a free gift. God loves us so much. And so I want to encourage you today that if you don't know the Lord, to invite him into your heart. And if you do that, will you text us the word hope to the number on the screen? We trust that you'll do that. Would you stand with me? Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that no matter what chapter we are in life, we are in that chapter with you. We thank you that you do not take your eye off the sparrow. We thank you that you know the number of the hairs on our head. We thank you that even the wicked man who loves his child, so much more do you love us. Lord, your love for us is abundant, is everlasting, and never ceases, that you never withhold your compassion, your gentleness, and your friendship to us. Thank you that because of Christ crucified, we can come boldly before your throne, that we don't need to be afraid, that we can trust in you. Lord, we believe. Help us with our unbelief. Lord, we believe. We trust. We count on you, and we depend on your word, and we thank you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. All God's people said, amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The preceding program was made possible in part by the ministry partners of the Hour of Power and viewers like you, and is accredited by the Evangelical Council for Financial.